This is a remote session. I have Dr. Taufik Amri, who's going to talk to us from Paris. The thing about him is he helps his clients implement intelligent automation into their business processes. How? By identifying tasks that can be performed better and are faster with AI. Measuring the value added by AI with advanced quantitative business process models and designing human-in-the-loop solutions. As a former quantum physicist, he also assesses and advises on implementing ready-to-use deep tech solutions, quantum computing, that can dramatically accelerate the optimization of their clients' business operations. I kindly welcome Taufik to go ahead and give us this presentation.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm really happy to be with you today, even through the Skype, in order to share with you our conviction about intelligent automation and how we hope to deploy it, and we deploy it through the business processes that Capgemini Business Services manage for our clients. So, I will share my screen. So here you have, so can you see my slide, please, for the organizer?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
So, the aim of my talk is about intelligent automation and how we can use artificial intelligence not only for replacing human operators by machines, but also for orchestrating tasks between machines and humans in order to reach the operational excellence expected by our clients. So, the outline of my talks are the following. The first is I will provide you what we call a crash course in data science. What is really possible with artificial intelligence? Actually, artificial intelligence is based on machine learning algorithms that learn from data. And if we want to understand what is possible with AI, with the current state of AI, we have to know more about the approach behind artificial intelligence. And this approach is data science. So I will show you what is this approach, what we can expect from such an approach, and what are the main limitations in the current state of artificial intelligence. After, we will see in the era of data and digital, how we can use data and analytics in order to know more about business processes as they are in the reality. For that, it's about what we call today the process mining, and how we can analyze business processes in order to know more about the reality of business processes from the IT systems that embody them in the information system of any company, any enterprise. This is the starting point of any business transformation as intelligent automation. And finally, we can see how to improve business operations with artificial intelligence. For that, we will propose a methodology to decide between machines and humans and how we can orchestrate them in order to reach a better efficiency while keeping the cost much lower than human operators. And we will provide an illustration. This illustration is a real case from an insurance company in France, and we will finish with the conclusion of this talk. So, for the beginning, what is really possible with artificial intelligence? For that, it's necessary to understand the underlying approach of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is not only about technology. Before technology, you have science. And it's necessary to understand the concepts behind artificial intelligence. For that, I will provide you an illustration here of data science for performance management. So, how performance management is viewed by data science? For that, we consider a business unit that we call B, like a data problem. And let Y be a performance indicator that is quantitative. For instance, the occupation rate, or the growth, or anything that can measure the performance of a business unit. This indicator generally depends on several business factors. And V best business factors can be non-deterministic. For data science, the performance indicator Y can be explained by a combination of some factors, and the link between the performance indicator and the business factors are actually what we call a model. The model is the link between what we are trying to explain or to predict, the performance indicator, and the business factors. And the business unit is actually viewed like a black box. Like a black box linking the performance indicator and the business factor X. For determining this link, we have data scientists. And data scientists are often viewed as the sexiest job of the 21st century. But in reality, the job of data scientists is to find a model by combining judiciously existing tools. We talk about data processing, features engineering, machine learning algorithm selection, etc. So, if we want to have a consistent approach in this empirical file, we have to use a scientific method. This is the only way that can ensure the best results for such an approach that is based on data. And this nature of data science leads to a data model dilemma. This data model dilemma is actually based on the nature of data science. Data science is an empirical approach. And the data science approach is based on the scientific method that is an inductive and iterative process between data and model. From data, we make hypotheses in order to find a model that explains the correlations and the fluctuations that we have observed on data. And we have to check the consistency of this model by checking on the real data. And if the test is wrong, we have to follow again this process in order to find another hypothesis and another model until finding the good model that describes the fluctuation and the correlations that we observe on data. But such an approach leads to a kind of chicken or the egg dilemma between data and model. We see that data are needed to determine the model describing them, while the model is necessary for leveraging data and to reveal the value of data. And when we talk about machine learning is a type of artificial intelligence that provides the computers the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. The scheme of the process is the following. You have labeled data, labeled by human operators, that are the teacher of the machines, and the machine learning algorithm learns from the data after several iterations. And then, in order to check that your model is a good model and the performances are good for prediction or for prescription, you have to check the prediction with a new set of data that set in order to do something that like an A/B testing. After that, you have new prediction and you can check with the reality in order to check the performances of your model. In this test and learn approach, data science is actually a test and learn approach, you have data from your operations, and you have to split them into three sets. The first one is what we call the learning set. This learning set is for what we call feature selection, features engineering, and model selection. It enables us to learn from data what can be the model explaining the fluctuation and the correlation that we have observed on the data. After that, we have an important step. This important step is to check that we have no issue with what we call the overfitting. And I will explain just after what is the overfitting issue. This validation set is used for tuning the model in order to be sure that we have learned the relation between data and not the data by heart. I will explain just after what is the issue when we have a model that have learned by heart all the data. And finally, we have to check the prediction, the predictive power or the prospective power of the model with an unknown data set that we call the test set in order to check the performances of this model. And all this data set should be representative and large enough for performing statistical work. Since machine learning is a name, but another name for the same thing is statistical learning. You need a huge amount of data in order to learn. You cannot do artificial intelligence without data. You have to learn from large data sets in order to be statistically significant. Machine learning is also called statistical learning. And this is an important point. Without data, we cannot do anything in artificial intelligence. So here, you see the issue, what we call the overfitting. When the machine becomes a statistical Turk, in reference to the mechanical Turk, if you know the story. You have three main situations. The first one is an undesired, unwanted situation, is the underfitting situation. You see here a relation between an indicator Y, that can be a performance indicator in performance management problem, and a business factor X. You see the data point, the real point that you have observed in your business unit, and the true relation is in green here. So you see the curve in green. But in another fitting model, you see that the relation between Y and X is actually represented simply by a line, a blue line. And this is actually an idiot redfish. This is a model that cannot explain the relation between data and cannot explain the fluctuation observed on data. The other extreme case corresponds to overfitting. Overfitting is also what I call a statistical Turk, in reference to the story of the mechanical Turk. In such model, you have a model that have learned by heart the data. You see that you have every data point that is actually fitted by the blue curve. So you can explain all the value of data, and you explain, apparently, also the fluctuation. But this is not the real model. The real model is in green. So machine learning corresponds to a model that have learned almost by heart the data. And you see this situation in the middle. This is the machine learning situation, the wanted situation that we want when we have artificial intelligence algorithm. We want that the model, the machine, learned almost by heart the data. And almost by heart means with an acceptable error rates. This is the key to understand. So machines are always doing mistakes. And this is the reason why we have limits in artificial intelligence. And here, I provide an example, the limits of deep learning algorithms. Deep learning algorithms are a subset of machine learning algorithms. And these algorithms are at the basis of artificial intelligence and the current state of artificial intelligence. With a limited efficiency, such an algorithm are not able to do something that is easy for a human being. It is still possible and easy to distinguish between machines and humans. You have here the CAPTCHA test. Everyone has experienced that. And it is simple to check that you have a machine or a human. And even though some machines fake humans in Turing-like tests, in newspaper, etc., they only succeed by reproducing a kind of artificial stupidity. Artificial stupidity is when you ask to a machine the age of universe times p, you will have the answer immediately. But for a human being, it's not possible. And if you want to fake humans in Turing-like tests, you have to reproduce an artificial stupidity instead of a real artificial intelligence. So now, we see that artificial intelligence is limited. But before automating a business process, we need to know the business process. And this is an important part of intelligent automation. This part is to analyze business process with data. This is a data-based approach in which we use data generated by the IT system embodied the processes in order to reveal the real process, the process as they are in reality. Why? There are three main reasons. The first one is subjectivity. Everyone has a subjective picture of the process depending on their role and perspective. This is the main reason why it is difficult to discover the real process from interview or workshop. The second one is partial view. There is not one single person that performs a complete process, but multiple stakeholders working together to deliver a product or service to the customer. And finally, the change. Processes change all the time, and even if a process is initially well documented, it's very hard to keep this process well documented and detailed through the time. These are the three main reasons why we cannot have a clear vision of the process of an enterprise, a company, simply by asking the stakeholders or by doing interview or by looking to the business rules. It's not possible. We have to use another approach, and this approach is actually based on data. How to realize such an approach is actually what we call process mining. Process mining is a file that combines data science and analytics and computer sciences. The process analysis and modeling is realized by leveraging data extracted from the IT systems, what we call the logs events. So you have several IT systems and generating logs events, and from this data we can do several things. The first one is process discovery. So you have the real process as they are in reality. You can do analytics by having graphical representation of this process, by having performance indicator, etc. And you can improve the business process by redesigning them. You have to redesign them, and you can monitor the process in reality to check that the process are following the business rules that you have redesigned after a transformation, like an intelligent automation. And what we get is something like that. You see here the main difference between an ideal process described by business rules and the process in reality. This graphical representation is the starting point of intelligent automation. This is from that we are trying to improve the business operation of our clients by using a methodology that I will discuss just after, in order to replace judiciously human operators by machine if it's possible and relevant, and keeping human in the loop in order to reach the efficiency expected by our clients. This is the main difference of the common vision of artificial intelligence, intelligent automation, in which some people are believing that we will replace every human by machine. This is not our vision. Our vision is to keep human in the loop, since some tasks are not performed by machines. Machines cannot do everything. So, with the process discovery, process mining reveals the operation orchestration without any prior knowledge about them, and process analytics provides graphical representation. And from this graphical representation, you see that you can discover hidden activities, bottlenecks, that are the main obstacle towards operational excellence expected by your clients. And after that, you can improve the business operations. For that, based on the graphical representation provided by the process mining approach, we can redesign and optimize the business process. So, how we can improve the business operations with AI? For that, at Capgemini Business Services, we have a methodology that is a methodology based on expert knowledge and good practices for each business operations, like accounting and finance, like HR, etc. So, SOR methodology was developed for improving the efficiency and effectiveness of business operations. This is actually based on 5 steps, and the main idea is, instead of automating every step of the process, SOR starts by eliminating all the wasteful tasks before re-engineering the process. And I will focus here on the 3 last steps. Since you have the first step is eliminate, all the wasteful activities, the bottlenecks and the hiding activities that are not useful. You have to standardize, and the, at the era of, in the era of data and digital, it's also meaning APIization and microservice. And after, you have to optimize business process, you have to automate, and you have to robotize. But these three last steps have a particular meaning at the era of intelligent automation. So, the foundation of intelligent automation are actually based on these three steps. The first one is optimize. And for us, optimize is the optimization by keeping human in the loops only for tasks requiring them while robotizing all the others. The second one is automate the processes with AI for orchestrating tasks between machines and humans. This is the meaning of automation. Automation is actually just an orchestration between tasks, of tasks and operations between machines and humans. And finally, robotize is about all the repetitive and highly demanded tasks with robots. What we call robots here is RPA solution provided by editors, etc., and AI apps. And generally, AI apps are developed for a particular case and a particular client. And we have a proven methodology for deciding between machines and humans. This methodology is based on three main steps, three levels. And it is for answering to the following question, how to decide between humans and machines. The first step is the simple one. After redesigning the process, you have to identify tasks that can be performed better and or faster with AI. And I will illustrate this in the following. The second one is to measure the value added by AI with an advanced quantitative model of the business process. Why? Since you can discover that sometimes a machine that is not efficient as human operators can always boost value in the process. Since you have a kind of a dirty, quick and dirty effect. So a machine that is faster than humans but less efficient can bring value depending on the position in the process. And finally, when it's not enough to reach the efficiency expected by our clients, we have to design human-in-the-loop solution. And for that, it's necessary to use AI to orchestrate operations between machines and humans. So, for identifying tasks that can be performed better or faster with AI, it's necessary to use the same metrics for comparing the performances of humans and machines. Machine learning algorithms that are at the basis of artificial intelligence are actually characterized by specific and dedicated metrics. We talk about confusion matrix, F-score, ROC curve, etc. If we want to decide between humans and machines, you have to characterize human performances according to the same metrics, which is very unusual for tasks performed by humans, but it is clearly necessary for making a rational decision between machines and humans. You have to use and to gather data about the performances of human operators, and you have to process this data in the same way that we do for machine learning algorithms, in order to have the same metrics to check the performances of human operators and machines. And then you can decide. After that, in order to measure the value added by AI with what we call an advanced quantitative models of business processes, we start with the results of process mining. Process mining reveals the actual business processes as they are structured and well represented by graphs. After redesigning a process, you have a new graph, and you can evaluate its global efficiency by using what we call Monte Carlo simulations, in which you generate all the possible scenarios given a business process, and these all possible scenarios, for each scenario, you can assess the value boosted by AI. And these simulations enable to quantify numerically by simulations, the value brought by AI before deciding to deploy and to implement AI. So we have clear a vision in which we are able to assess the process efficiency for machines, but also with humans in the loop, but also the cost per operation. And this is clearly a vision in which the redesign of a business process is viewed as an engineering problem. And for instance, you can discover some surprising effect. Some tasks that can be performed by machines that are less efficient but faster than humans can still add value in some cases. We call this a quick and dirty effect. And this quick and dirty effect depends on the position in the graphical representation describing your business process. Sometimes it is relevant to replace a human operator by a machine that is less efficient than the human operators, but faster. And they still add value in the business process. And you can discover this kind of quick and dirty effect only by doing this kind of quantitative modeling of your business process and by simulating all the possible scenarios by the method that I have mentioned just before. And finally, when we talk about designing human in the loop, it is redesigning and automating the process by using the SOR methodology and the rules that we have described just before. But for tasks that cannot be totally managed by humans, artificial intelligence can be trained for orchestrating the operations between machines and humans. And here you see what we call the fundamental scheme of intelligent automation. This fundamental scheme is actually an intelligent orchestration of operation between machine in green and human in red. And you see that the AI orchestrator here, in blue, is characterized by what we call a confusion matrix. This confusion matrix corresponds to the performances of the AI orchestrator in orchestrating tasks between machines and humans. Namely, it provides the error rates and the mistakes involved by this orchestration. So we are taking in account all the errors involved by such an orchestration. And we can easily demonstrate that the process efficiency is better than the machine one, while keeping the cost much lower than the human one, if you are able to train an AI algorithm in order to recognize tasks that can be managed by machines and those that can be only handled by humans. And you see here that machine in green and human in red are characterized in the same way. For machine, you have a confusion matrix with an efficiency. Alpha F here is the efficiency with which the machine is doing the task efficiently. And for human, you have the same thing, alpha H, corresponding to the process efficiency. And the human operator is also characterized by cost per operation. And by taking into account all these things, you can assess the process efficiency and the cost per operation. And if you are able to do the orchestration with an acceptable error rates, you can then orchestrate operation between machine and humans. And now we have an illustration. This illustration is provided by an European insurance company based in France. The context is the following. You have a process dedicated to for the treatment and the processing of almost a huge volume of quotes, dental quotes, provided by dentists in several and various quote formats. So you have no predefined templates for this dental quotes. And you have volume in a year that is almost 215,000 quotes per year. And in this process, that was originally completely performed by human operators, you have 25 FTE distributed among the five main regional entities in France. So the original process is based on four steps. You see here the data quote reading, the input into the legacy system, validation of the payback, and communication to the customer. The average time is almost 9 minutes, 10 minutes for doing this per quote. And we have used an RPA solution provided by one of our partners, and this RPA solution is able to do a cognitive task that we call OCR, optical character recognition, and data extraction. But you have always human involved in the process. You have only one intervention of human, that is about data checking. And when you have the data checking, you have after the RPA performing the input into the legacy system, the validation of the payback, and the communication to the customer. And now you have an average time which corresponds to 3 minutes per quote. So the impact after training the process on 1,000 quotes is that 85% of quotes are now processed directly by the RPA solution. In terms of time saving, you have more than 60% of time reduction since you have divided the original time, the operating time, by a factor of 3. And in terms of cost saving, you see that you have almost a reduction by a factor 2. But this is based on this design. This is a sequential design in which you have always the human in the loop, but this is a particular design. We have proposed this design. This design is based on an AI orchestrator at the very beginning of the process. And in order to assess the value boost by the AI orchestrator, we have to make some assumptions. The first one is that the fraction of documents that can be totally managed by the machine is what we call here M, is 85%. 85% of quotes can be processed by machines, here RPA solution, directly and totally managed with a good efficiency. And after that, you see that AI orchestration is characterized by a perfect confusion matrix. So we assume that we have no orchestration errors between machines and humans. This means that the AI orchestrator is able to recognize perfectly the operations that are managed by machine and those that can be only handled by humans. And the RPA efficiency can be much higher than 85% by definition of the AI orchestrator. Since the aim and the role of the AI orchestrator is to send to the RPA solution, to the machine here in green, all the documents that can be processed directly without the human intervention. And if it's not the case, we send to the human in order to be data checking and to realize actually the data extraction if necessary. And you see here the distribution between machines and humans, and you can easily compute the expected impact. In terms of time savings, the average time is here dominated by the time of the human operators. We assume that the time of machine is small enough compared to the time of human operators. And here you see that it corresponds to the fraction of quotes that cannot be processed by machines times the operating time associated with the human operators. And you see that you have less than 1 minute per operation. This corresponds to 80% of time saving. In terms of cost saving, we assume a linear, affine relation between the number of FTE and the operating time. And you see that initially you have a reduction by a factor 2, now you have a reduction by a factor around almost 5, since you have only 6 FTE by using this AI orchestration. The value is behind this orchestration, since this orchestration is based on a machine learning algorithm that is able to recognize quotes that can be processed directly by machines. In terms of quality improvement, what we have is that the process efficiency is actually the average between the human efficiency and the RPA efficiency. We assume that the human efficiency is almost 100%. And the fraction of quotes that can be processed by human operators, that have to be processed by human operators, is 15% here. And the RPA efficiency is much higher than the 85% initially observed on the previous design. when you compute here, you can easily check that you have an improvement in terms of the efficiency. But here, all these calculations are based on assumption about the confusion matrix, mainly about the confusion matrix of the AI orchestration. But in reality, if we want to take into account a real orchestration, this corresponds only to a small transformation. This corresponds to a transformation of the fraction M in another fraction that takes into account all the orchestration. Since if we have a real AI orchestration, this real AI orchestration will do mistake. And mistake, what is mistake? Is to send a human operation to the machines. And if it's the case, you have an efficiency that is lower than expected. But you can have another situation in which the AI orchestrator sends a machine operations to the human operators. And in this case, you will have an improvement of the efficiency, of the expected efficiency, that is the baseline that we have calculated just before. And you have simply to replace the fraction by a realistic fraction in which you have a clear formula, a simple formula, taking into account all the errors involved by the AI orchestrator. So the main conclusion is that AI is not capable of doing everything, but it is able of recognizing which task operation can be managed by machine and those that can be only handled by humans. And this is our vision, and this is the way with which we redesign the business processes for our clients. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Taufik. Thanks a lot. Really appreciate it. Any questions? Can they take questions? Any questions? So thanks, Taufik. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. So
thank you
for your time as well. Thank you. We will get ready for the next session. Our feedback. Yeah, thank you. We'll go ahead and do the feedback for a minute.